Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Origin of Names, Words, and Everything in Between by Patrick Foote. Narrated by Jonathan Cowley. Hello. Why, hello there. You have made a very good decision in life, which has resulted in you owning this book. Perhaps you were gifted this book by some estranged family member, or maybe you purchased it for yourself after wandering aimlessly through a dark, musty bookstore. Nevertheless, you are here now. Welcome to this fun little book that I have had the honor of writing and that you shall have the honor of reading. There are so many fun and incredible facts throughout this book that not only do I hope you enjoy reading, but sharing with your friends and family. That's what I love about these kinds of facts and etymologies. You know when you hear something so fascinating that you can't help but tell everyone you know? That is perhaps what I get the biggest kick out of in life. Yet, maybe I'm going a bit too fast for you. I am sure you have a lot of questions. Unless you watch the YouTube channel, then you might even be thinking to yourself, who even is this guy? And why is he so obsessed with names? Well, let me do what I do best and explain all of that for you. Name explain, explained. My name is Patrick Foote. The name Patrick has its roots all the way back to ancient Rome with the patrician class of people, the patricians being the noble founding families of Rome, though I fancy myself a bit more of a pleb. And the surname Foote seems to come from the Norse who came to Britain, deriving from Fotre, thought to be the name given to messengers and fast runners, though if you've seen my physical health, you'd gather I am far from the fastest of runners. If you read that and thought, that's pretty boring, and I definitely do not care to know where the names of countless other things came from, then not only do you have a very specific thought process, but this book is probably not for you, as the rest of the names being explained within this book are much more exciting than my silly name. If you did read that and it sparked the slightest bit of interest, even just a flicker of curiosity about the world of etymology, etymology being the study of the origins of words, you'll read it quite a bit here, then congratulations. You are just as weirdly fascinated in the history of words and names as I am, you big nerd. So that's my name explained, but of course I am more than just a name. I'm guessing a lot of you will know me from my popular YouTube channel, Name Explain, where I do exactly what the channel says it does. Explain the names of various things. Countries, cities, animals, historic figures, food, video game characters, anything goes on the channel. Perhaps what's most interesting is how I can pinpoint the exact moment I discovered just how interesting names and their origins can be. My interest in names came way before I had any idea that I was going to work as a YouTuber. I remember being stuck in the back seat of the car with my brother and parents up front. We were horrendously lost in the Netherlands, with seemingly no hope of finding our campsite, which would be home for the next couple weeks. On our adventures being copiously lost, we ended up in a part of the Netherlands I never knew existed. It was a selection of islands surrounded by water, connected by bridges and underground tunnels. What an odd place to find yourself in. It was only after the camping trip was over, we eventually found our way, when I was back in Blighty, I took to Wikipedia to find out what this place was. The land is called Zealand. Its name in English, unsurprisingly, Zealand. And it is, if you will, the Old Zealand to the southern country of New Zealand. Since learning this, this fun little fact stayed with me. Why was no one else talking about Old Zealand? And it stuck with me all through my many failed attempts at being a YouTuber. Until one day, while working on another now defunct channel, I decided to write a video script called Where's Old Zealand? And Other Old and New Places, which eventually became just Where's Old Zealand? I felt it was so different to the rest of my videos on that old channel that I made a whole new channel for it, as well as ideas for more videos about names, and simply dubbed the new channel Name Explain, and here we are now. What's in this book? In this book, you will find a multitude of names being explained, from the names of humble things like childhood toys and creepy crawlies, to huge nations and even the planets in our solar system. My aim is to cover as much as I can in this simple book, in a way that everyone can understand. For people new to me explaining names, I hope as much as possible that this book is new to you. And what if you're a long-time supporter of the channel and have seen all the videos on there? Well, first off, thank you. My soul and bank account are much healthier because of you. Second, there are topics covered in this book that have never been covered on the channel. Think of this book as a best hits album. But with subjects already covered on the channel, there will be new facts sprinkled in. Perhaps most importantly, you won't have to deal with hearing me mispronouncing every word possible. Let's get into it. Countries. If you are not reading this on a boat, plane, submarine, hot air balloon, moon, extraterrestrial planet, or literally the sun, are you a bit warm by any chance? Then you are most likely reading this in a country. Each country on this planet has a deep history, culture of their own individual to them, and of course, a name. Much like the history of the country, the names also have deep and interesting histories. A far more sensible book would put these countries in alphabetical or maybe geographical order. This, however, isn't that sensible book. Imagine this as something of a world tour. One moment you may be reading about a cold Nordic country. The next you're in the Caribbean. Let's take a look. Russia. Let's kick things off with that huge country of Russia. It can be hard to imagine just how big Russia is, seeing it on a map. But did you know that the country covers 11 time zones? When it is midnight in Moscow, the people of Petropavlovsk-Kamchatsky are already getting on with their day. Russia is so huge that the entirety of the United Kingdom, Germany, France and Spain can fit into it with plenty of room to spare. Like a lot of countries that we will come across, Russia was named after the people who lived and settled the land. In this case being the Rus people. The Rus were a tribe of Vikings who are thought to have come from Sweden in the 9th century. Even though the lands of Russia were populated at the time, some scholars believe that the local people of the town of Novgorod in Russia asked them to come to settle their disputes with each other. Imagine that, if you were arguing with your brother or sister so much that you both came to the decision to ask your parents for help. Nevertheless, the Rus stayed in the land, founding cities and opening up trade routes around the country, so much so that by the 16th century, we have evidence the land was called in medieval Latin, Rusi, meaning the people of Russia. If Russia is named after the Rus people, then how did the Rus people get their name? It's thought that their name comes from the Old Norse term, rods, meaning the men who row. As rowing was the main way the Rus and all other Vikings traversed the waters around them. Pakistan. When you hear a name like Pakistan, you would think its roots lie in the ancient world, as it's an equally ancient-sounding name. Yet what if I told you the name of Pakistan can not only be pinpointed to an exact date, but also pinpointed to the exact location it was coined? The time and place? Well, it wasn't somewhere in India thousands of years ago, but it was first recorded on the 28th of January, 1933, at No. 3 Humberstone Road, Cambridge, England. It was in this house that Indian expat student Chaudhry Ramat Ali wrote his Now or Never, Are We to Live or Perish Forever pamphlet. Ramat expressed his belief that his fellow Muslims living in the provinces of India should gain independence and have their own nation. He dubbed this nation Pakistan, with the I being added later. The name is an acronym of the names of the Indian provinces he wished were independent from India. The P comes from Punjab, the A from the Afghan province, the K from Kashmir, the S from Sindh, and the Tan coming from Baluchistan, but the Stan suffix is seen with other nations such as Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and comes from the Persian and Urdu language, meaning the place of. Speaking of the Persian language, the name takes on another meaning in this language. In Persian, the name means the place of the pure, as Pak is the Persian word for pure. So yes, Pakistan's name is an acronym and a pun rolled into one. Australia. Australia is the country of the Aboriginals, a people with their own amazing mythology. Yet the name we all know the country as today has its roots in Greek mythology. The Greeks had a god for everything. Dionysus was the Greek god of wine. Priapos was the god of vegetable gardens. But the Greek god we are interested in today is Notus/Notos, the Greek god of the southern wind. The Romans adopted the Greek mythology for themselves, but one thing they did was change the names of the gods. Zeus became Jupiter, Ares became Mars, and Notus's name was changed to Auster by the Romans. With the name of the god of the southern wind being Auster, Auster became a term for south/southern in general through Latin, and Latin is a language with a huge influence in the English language. This was most noticeable with the concept of Terra Australis during the 15th and 16th centuries. Before our planet had been fully explored, a lot of mapmakers had to guess and predict what land there was in undiscovered parts of the world. At that time, we knew there were copious amounts of land in the Northern Hemisphere, so there must have been huge amounts of land in the Southern Hemisphere too. When the land was first discovered by Dutch explorer Abel Tasman, he dubbed the land he found as New Holland. Pretty obvious explanation there. Abel was Dutch after all. But that name didn't stick. James Cook first set foot on the island in 1770 and dubbed it New South Wales. But it was Captain Matthew Flinders in the 1800s who was the first to navigate the entire coast of the land, proving it was in fact an island, that popularized the name Australia, referencing the legendary Terra Australis in its name. The name became official in 1824. France. France, much like the nation of Russia, is named after the people who lived there, in this case being the Franks. The country's Latin name is Francia, which means country of the Franks. The name originally belonged to the entire Frankish kingdom, which at its peak not only included the majority of modern France, but parts of modern Germany, the Netherlands, Belgium, Switzerland, and Spain. The Franks were originally a Germanic people who lived in the north of Europe, around the Rhine River. They descended upon the land of France, which back then was called Gaul under the control of Julius Caesar and the Roman Empire, and made it their own. But how exactly did the Franks get their name? Traditionally, one of the popular theories of how they got their name is after their weapon of choice, a type of throwing axe that was called a Francisca. How cool is it that France is a country named after a people named after a weapon? I mean, it would be cool if it were true. More recent evidence points to the axe being named after the people, rather than the other way around. Nowadays, it's more believed that the name Franks means freeman, coming from the Old English frank slash franca, meaning free, possibly due to the fact that the Franks were tax-free after they conquered Gaul. It is also from this idea of being free where the term to be frank is thought to come from, meaning to be free to do slash say as you wish. The United States of America. Now, of course, this country isn't simply called America, but the country is commonly referred to as just that. What is just called America, sort of, is the continent that the USA is situated on. Some consider the landmass with Canada in the north and Chile in the south as a single continent of the Americas, while others break them into two separate continents of North America and South America. Panama is generally considered to be the most southern part of North America, with Colombia being the most northern part of South America on the mainland. The story everyone seems to know is that of Christopher Columbus being the first European to discover and set foot on America. Yet the person we are much more interested in today is Italian explorer Amerigo Vespucci. While Columbus still thought that the land he discovered was the western side of Asia, it was Amerigo who put forward the idea that the land was in fact completely separate from Asia, and with foresight on our side, we know who was correct there. Amerigo didn't name the land after himself. What a humble guy. And instead, simply called this land the New World, as it was land completely new to the Europeans who went on to traverse it all. So, who was it that named the land after the Italian explorer? That honour goes to the German mapmaker Martin Waldseemüller. When he was creating a map to reflect all the discoveries made, imagine being alive at the time when the maps weren't finished yet. He took it upon himself to label the area where, at my estimation, modern Argentina, Chile, and Paraguay are, as simply America. Coming from the Latinization of Amerigo's name, Americus Vespucius, Amerigo Vespucci is thought to be named after Saint Emeric of Hungary, meaning that the name America was coined by a German who named it after an Italian who was named after a Hungarian. As for the United States of part of the country's name, well, that's not as exciting. When the country gained its independence, it was just that, a collection of states that were united. It started with the 13 founding colonies and now is the 50 states we all know today. The term's earliest recording is from an anonymous article written in a Virginian newspaper in 1776 with United States of America going on to appear in the draft of the Declaration of Independence and in the preamble of the Constitution itself. Kenya. Kenya, of all things, has ostriches to thank for how it got its name. Okay, so that might be a bit of a stretch, but regardless, the name Kenya strikes up the impression of the classic, almost prehistoric idea of Africa many have in mind, yet that name is pretty modern. We don't really have any idea of what the people of the land would have called Kenya. The name was officially given to the land when it was declared a crown colony of Britain in 1920. The country is named after Mount Kenya, the second tallest mountain in Kenya, and one of its most iconic landmarks. So how did Mount Kenya get its name? There's multiple suggestions to how this name came to be. One of the more popular stories is when Johann Ludwig Krapf and Johannes Riebmann, two missionaries exploring the land in 1846, asked their native guide what they called the huge mountain they saw in the distance. The guide told them that the mountain was called Kima Kya Kenya, in his language of Kamba. Kenya translates to glitter or shine in relation to the shining ice that capped the mountain. Nonetheless, Kamba wasn't the only language in the region. The Amaru people called the mountain Kirimira, which means mountain of white feather, once again referencing the ice on the mountains. The Kikuyu people called the mountain Kirinyaga or Kirinyaga, which can be either translated to God's resting place or the place with the ostriches. Some even feel the mountain looks similar to the male ostrich, with the black of the mountain and the white of the snow showing the same colours as the huge flightless birds. But like I said, it's a tad of a stretch. It was one of these dialect names for the mountain that led to the mispronunciation in English as Kenya. Great Britain. Okay, so hear me out. I know technically there is no country simply called Great Britain. Great Britain is the geographic name for the island that is home to England, Wales, and Scotland, which joins up with Northern Ireland to become the country of the United Kingdom. But come on, the name the UK is kind of boring. Great Britain, on the other hand, has a much more interesting etymology. The name of just Britain has its roots in a tribe of people that Greek explorer Pytheas came across in the land of Britain in the 4th century BCE. These people were called the Britanni, leading to Pytheas giving two names to the land he found them in, Britannia and Britannique. These two names led to the creation of just one name, Britannia, which sounds an awful lot like a name we still hear today, Britannia. So with the Britanni and the name Britannique for the country, where did the B at the start of its name come from? Well, it seems that when writing, Pytheas had a habit of using P's and B's interchangeably. It was the spelling with the B that stuck around when the Romans took over the land and dubbed it the province of Britannia. Yet this Roman province only covered modern-day England and Wales. So what was going on with Scotland? Alas, the Romans could never truly conquer the Scottish, so they stayed as they were, separated from Britain, with the Roman part of Britain eventually became known as the Kingdom of England. The great in Great Britain kind of has two different meanings. The first being that it's the greater in size Britain compared to France's Brittany. But it officially got the title of Great Britain when the Kingdom of England and the Kingdom of Scotland joined their monarchy together when King James VI became king of both nations, coming together to be called the United Kingdom of Great Britain. Yet Britain is also sometimes referred to by a different name, Blighty. While this might just sound like a cute pet name for the land, there is actually more history to it than that. The nickname was born out of a sense of homesickness that Brits away from the country came to use with affection like during the peak of the Victorian rule of India and in the trenches of World War I. It comes from the Urdu word vilaiti, which means things like foreign, English or European, becoming a common name Europeans visiting India would be called. At one point, the V was misheard as a B, and Blighty became Blighty, Blimey. The Netherlands. If you think of this land of windmills, stroopwafel, clogs, and tulips, then you may have heard it referred to as a different name, Holland. The country, however, is actually called the Netherlands. So why does this one nation seemingly have two interchangeable names, and more importantly, where do these two names even come from? So what's the difference between these two names? Well, simply put, Holland is a region of the Netherlands. Calling all of the Netherlands Holland would be like calling all of the United States of America just Texas. The region of Holland in the Netherlands is on the country's west coast and is actually split into the two provinces of North and South Holland. The whole country gets mistakenly called Holland because so much of the nation's identity is within the Holland regions. Holland is home to all the classically Dutch things, like the aforementioned windmills and tulips. Holland is also home to some of the Netherlands' most famous cities, such as The Hague, Delft, Rotterdam, and of course, Amsterdam. The name of the Netherlands does not have the most exciting of origins. It is simply the land of Nether. But what exactly does this mean then? The word Nether means a few very similar things: low, under, and beneath. As in how a certain part of your body is called the Nether regions, or even the hellscape in Minecraft that is also called the Nether, but the Netherlands has little to do with your private area or a blocky hell. The Nether in Netherlands refers to just how low and flat the country is. In fact, it's not just low to the sea level. About one third of the country's land is beneath sea level. This makes the Netherlands really quite a nether land. The name of Holland, however, is thought to come from the old Dutch words for wood, holt, and the old Dutch word for land, land. Meaning the name in Old Dutch translates to woodland, though weirdly there's not actually that much woodland in Holland. A folklore etymology of the name Holland is that it comes from the term hollow land, once again referencing Holland's below sea level geography. The Isle of Man. Now, I know what you're thinking. Is the Isle of Man even a country? Well, sort of. It's something that is called a crown dependency, meaning that it is part of the British Crown, but not a part of the UK. So even though they use the British pound, they have their own variation of it, as well as their own flag, language, passport, and government. At first glance, the name of the country might seem incredibly sexist. An island just for men? But I can assure you that there are both men and women living on the Isle of Man. The man in the Isle of Man does not refer to the entire male sex of the island, but rather one man, whose name also happens to be Man, as his full name is Mananon Mac Ilir in the Manx language. Mananon is a god of Celtic and Manx mythology. Thought to be the son of Lir, the Irish god of the sea, making his son Lord of the Sea. Mananon is believed to be the first ruler of the island and also lent his name to the island. The Isle of Man inhabitants hold deeply onto their mythology, claiming that the severe winds, fog, and mists that cover the island at times are his cloak, protecting the island from outsiders. What's also interesting about the Isle of Man is the variety of languages that have been introduced to the island over its history. The island has roots in Celtic languages that can be seen with the name of the island's capital, Douglas, thought to come from the early Celtic Dubla Glacio, meaning Black River, while the town of Ramsey on the island was given its name from the Viking settlers of the island, coming from the Old Norse Goramza, meaning Wild Garlic River. Japan. Japan's famous nickname is the Land of the Rising Sun, but this nickname also shines some light, see what I did there, on the country's actual name too. The name has its roots all the way to the Chinese Ji Pun, which translates into sunrise. Chinese referred to Japan by this name due to where Japan is in relation to China. Japan is east to China, and of course, it's from the east that the sun rises. The names of Japan are often associated with China, as ancient China had a huge influence on the early civilizations of Japan. Yet this wasn't their first name for the country. Originally, China referred to Japan under the simple name Wa, which is thought to mean things ranging from submissive and obedient to even meaning dwarf or pygmy. Unsurprisingly, the people of Japan didn't like this name for the land. It was Japanese Prince Shotoku who first coined the term Land of the Rising Sun when writing to the Chinese Emperor of the time. He referred to Japan as the land of the rising sun, and to China as the land of the setting sun, which clearly is a nickname that hasn't become as popular in China. All of this led to Japan's name is kanji. Kanji is one of the writing systems of Japan and has its origins in China.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.